we're going to shed some light into the rich life of the late King Abdullah ibn Abdulaziz, the King of Saudi Arabia. As we all know, may his soul rest in peace. Of course, we are going to look into the distinguished relations between the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and Egypt that have lasted for years and will last for forever, hopefully, inshallah. And of course, we are going also to study the future of this distinguished relationships with the new monarch, and where is it taking the whole region? Because as we all know, the statesman, the strong statesman, has left his traces and has left a lot of achievements that have taken its course in developmental process in the region and have had his effect or his own personality with developing or tackling different thorny issues. And we remember from that the Middle East peace process and the relations with the superpowers and how he had that strong stance, that the backbone, that he became strong stance while backing Egypt during June 30th revolution and later after that. A lot more, we're going to discuss it with our distinguished guest, Ambassador Hussein Haridi, former Assistant Foreign Minister. Good morning, Your Excellency.
Good morning to you.
How are you doing?
Good morning to you, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, as Dina said, whenever we are talking about the Egyptian-Saudi ties, we are historical, deeply rooted, and inshallah, we don't think that anything would be an obstacle on the way to continue this way. But let me ask you about the most important challenges which are going to face the new king and the timing of losing King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz in this very critical period of the modern history of the region in general, not only Egypt.
Allow me first to start by expressing my deep sadness on the death of Ms. Shaima Al-Sabbar yesterday. And I present my sincerest condolences to her family and to the party to which she was a member. Answering your question, definitely there is no mistaking that not only Saudi Arabia but the Arab world and the Muslim world and the international community lost a great pillar for coexistence, understanding, peace, security, stability in the world. And when we review the speeches and the decisions by the former King Abdullah, we will be really struck by his attachment to coexistence between different civilizations. And he was a steadfast promoter of a dialogue among religions, and he held various meetings in Mecca and in Riyadh to promote such an idea that humanity has to learn how to coexist in mutual respect between the three great religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, as well as he was also a great supporter for what came to be known as the dialogue among civilizations. In the same context, he fought terrorism, whether on the whether ideologically or through security means. And back in 2005, Saudi Arabia hosted an international conference to face extremism and terrorism. And he also proposed the establishment of a fund to fight terrorism, which was done. And last year, the Saudi Kingdom contributed the sum of $100 million to this fund. The role of the fund is to conduct research to understand the phenomenon of terrorism and extremism, and to recommend measures, whether in security, political, social, in order to contain this phenomenon. One particular aspect that I really admired in King Abdullah policies. But before I proceed, let me state that in the future, when historians, political scientists would look back on his reign, they would say that he was the great modernizer and the great reformer of Saudi Arabia. And to give you just two examples, one will concern women and the role of women in Saudi society, mm-hmm. and the second one is the role of youth mm-hmm. In the development, in the what we call sustainable development in Saudi Arabia. As far as women are concerned, let me refer to two decisions that he took. One was to appoint a deputy minister, a lady deputy minister, mm-hmm. and this in itself is some kind of a mini revolution mm-hmm. in Saudi society.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he was asked once during a meeting with journalists, Saudi journalists, to discuss many issues concerning the Saudi Arabia and the Saudi people. One journalist asked him, why don't we appoint a lady minister? Mm-hmm. So his answer was really the answer of a statesman. He told him, let's start with a deputy minister as a lady, mm-hmm. let her prove herself, mm-hmm. And then once she had proved herself, we would appoint, we won't hesitate to appoint a lady minister in Saudi Arabia. If you are familiar with the traditions of the Saudi society, you will take that as really a mini evolution. The second example, youth. In his reign, Saudi Arabia sent, and don't get surprised by the figure, if Saudi Arabia has 170,000 students studying all over the world, from east to west, in secondary schools, in universities, to get their BAs, and to get their MAs and PhDs. And I ask you just to reflect, and I asked, of course, our telespectators to reflect, when the 170,000 students will earn their degrees and will go back to their dear country, Saudi Arabia, just imagine the effect that will have on sustainable development in the long term. Mm-hmm. And personally speaking, I consider this decision and its implementation, the fact that you have today, while we are speaking, 170,000 Saudi students all over the world studying and working hard to earn their degrees, from high school certificates to PhD, then I would say this is itself is a renewable wealth. And this will prove to be the only renewable wealth of any society. Mm-hmm. So, of course, politically speaking, let me refer to the fact that King Abdullah is the one who promoted the Arab Peace Initiative. Mm-hmm. You may recall that when he was Crown Prince back in 2002, he came up with the plan, what's called the Abdullah Initiative, and which was adopted in 2002 by the Arab Summit in Beirut, and then reaffirmed once again in an Arab Summit in 2007. This is that concerns the Arab-Israeli conflict, but one of the most important contributions of King Abdullah would prove to be the Gulf reconciliation and the Arab reconciliation that he sealed last November in Riyadh.
Yeah.
And in this context, his call on Egypt and the Egyptian people and government to contribute to the success of this reconciliation by really opening up to Qatar.
Mm-hmm.
And on December 20th or 21st, he sent his chief cabinet with an emissary from the Emir of Qatar to meet the Egyptian president in Cairo in order just to, let me put it this way, to break the ice between the two countries. And I, speaking of which, I believe that King Salman bin Abdul Aziz will continue on this path, the path of an all-out relation. And the promotion of an Egyptian-Qatari reconciliation as well.
Right. I would like to take it from here, King Salman ibn Abdul Aziz. If we look into the life, the rich life of the late King Abdullah ibn Abdul Aziz, we could clearly see someone, a man, a great man, who has taken the image or maintained the image of a statesman with integrity, with foresight, with a clear vision of the future, a politician, a sharp politician, and also the wisdom. We can find it in all the acts and deeds that you have mentioned, his empowerment of women's rights and encouraging women to integrate into society, and also his stance, staunch opponent to being a staunch opponent towards extremism, and how he has backed Egypt after June 30th, and his respectable character dealing with leaders of superpowers and all that. So probably if we talk about the new king who is succeeding King Abdullah ibn Abdul Aziz, we would focus on many points, and we could be curious to be raising some questions. So if you could assess the situation now, especially with the timing of what's happening in Yemen.
I personally believe, and many others do also share my convictions, that King Salman, as well as Crown Prince Mudrin and the Deputy Crown Prince Emir Mohammed bin Naif, are very capable of steering the ship of Saudi Arabia in the tumultuous waters in the Arab world right now. The positions taken by Saudi Arabia to deal with the upheavals that the Arab world have seen during the last 4 years were not decisions taken by one man, but by state, by government, by country, that knows fully well what's going on around and has a clear vision for the future. And that's what we share with Saudi Arabia, whether